So the first reading is from the section in the prophet Ezekiel. It's often pointed out as being, you know, the first announcement really of individual responsibility as opposed to group responsibility. You know, during the Exodus, the people as a whole were punished and rewarded because they tended to act, you know, as a whole. The first glimmers of, you know, the individual, first individual responsibility are here in these passages of Ezekiel. But you can still wonder sometimes, you know, just how far does it go? How far do we really understand, you know, the moral life? Is it just, one's following the will, one's not following the commandments, etc.? If we look at the second reading today, we're introduced to a whole shocking new world, which is the very basis of Christianity, the very essence of Christianity, and yet somehow we're not shocked enough by it to really get what it's saying. First of all, you might hear certain revisionists, historical revisionists, say, well, you know, the Christians, they only made Jesus God in the 4th century. Before that, you can't say that in the face of this magnificent early Christian hymn which we have right here from Philippians. Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped and clung to, but rather emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. That's pretty clear. And yet here again, what does that actually mean? It's true we get the Nicene Creed from the 4th century, but this is not primarily a doctrinal proposition. We turn it into that to escape its practical, moral, and mystical, and ascetical implications. Oh yes, I believe. Well, what do you believe exactly? What does it mean for our lives? Well, it means we should have, as we just heard, have the same attitude in you as was in Christ Jesus. We're supposed to behave like him. In fact, more than that, we're supposed to have his actual mind and heart. And it has a couple of other interesting phrases there to introduce to him there in Philippians, where it says, you know, be of one mind. Think the same thing, it says. Be of one mind, Christ's mind, have that mind in you, which is Christ. It even says, be co-souled, is literally the word. S-O-U-L-E-D. Have the same soul. Be conjoined in soul. Have the same soul with one another and with Christ. Okay, good. So that sounds very threateningly mystical. What does it come out down to in practice then? Well, he emptied himself. He did not consider equality above with God something to, it's a word that means booty, something to be robbed, you know, clung to as booty, you know, as some kind of spoil, you know, of war. He didn't cling to that, he rather emptied himself. And I would propose, and many Catholic Christian writers are proposing today, that that's the essence of spirituality. Emptying yourself. It's called the kenosis in Greek. We use it in theology to Christ's kenosis. He emptied himself. I think the Buddhists give us a good clue here as well. And people are pointing that out, how similar they are in this respect, precisely in this respect. The notion you may have heard of emptiness in Buddhism. Sounds a little nihilistic or something, but it should be understood from a practical point of view in terms of what we're just hearing about Jesus. What emptiness means in Buddhism is that you don't allow any definition or any limitation of yourself or God or reality to get in the way of having that one mind and that one heart, that mind with Christ, that infinite mind of Christ. So you don't define or limit yourself. It's empty of all complacent definitions and attitudes. So you see the practicality of it. Oh, I'm righteous, I'm American, I'm Catholic, I'm male, I'm white, I'm straight, whatever it might be. Empty yourself. None of that is you. Your full essence of who you really are. You are Christ. have that mind and heart in you which is in him, who emptied being God, but not consider that something to be clung to. How much less our, you know, qualifications, definitions, or attributes that we cling to in our righteousness or in our complacence. Empty yourself of all that and follow Christ's path. My teacher in Zen is a Jesuit priest, and his Japanese teacher, whose aunt was a Catholic nun, said, I don't want to make a Buddhist out of you. I just want to make you conform to your Lord Jesus, quoting this passage. So we have to take this whole lot more seriously. What will it actually mean? Taking the form of a slave, being in the likeness of humanity, emptying yourself, becoming obedient to death on the cross, all these deaths that we have to go through. But what Jesus did on the cross, and this is customary ascetical theology, moral theology, he took on the sufferings and sin of the whole world, of all people of all time. He spent his physical life healing people at all sorts of levels, including the physical. And then he took it all on himself. By his wounds we were healed. He took all upon himself the sufferings of all, as the serpent song says that we read on Good Friday. That's what it means to empty yourself of all your complacency and your limitation, to take on the sufferings and the sin and the darkness and the grief and the fear and the sorrow and the pain and the joy and the hope of the whole world. Have that mind in us, which we see in Christ Jesus. That mind and that heart, which lets go of all our complacencies and limitations and is willing to take on the heart and soul of all people of all time, because think the same thing. Be co-souled. Have the same soul. You do have the same soul. So live it. Don't think you're better or different from anybody else, anytime, anywhere, in any place in history. You want to be like Jesus, emptied out or not? Have this mind in you. And that means we do let our heart be explode it open, blow our minds to be able to take on the reality of all people, because it's our reality. The Buddhists know that. We should know that. Because that's what we're asked to do. So emptiness means the fullness, as they say too, of taking on everyone and everything. As God does. Jesus is the mirror of God, of the Father. That's who God is, that's who the Father is. Emptying himself into the Son and into the world. Jesus as the image of God, the Son of God, the Word of God, does the same thing. The Spirit of God makes that process operative in the world and in the Trinity. So that's what's divine. And that's the final caution here. When it says, therefore God exalted him and gave him the name above every name, so that every knee should bend on heaven and earth and under the earth, say Jesus Christ is Lord, confess it to God, the glory of God the Father. Please don't imagine that means, okay, well, once we humble ourselves, then it will be exalted again. And we'll go back the way it was in the beginning. Up there with a big crown and a self-satisfied smile, getting all the glory. Whether Jesus or us sitting next to him. Sometimes when you hear, if you exalt yourself, you'll be humble, but if you humble yourself, you'll be exalted. You have the same kind of ideas. Sometimes, well, let's just humble myself a little bit now. Later, I'll be up there. No! It's a whole different ballgame. When you take on all of reality in Christ, as Christ, you come out the other side in a resurrection which includes forever all of that. You never go back to the way it was in the beginning. The wounds are still in the hands and the feet and the side. Ours too. So the humility, the poverty, is the exaltation, is the riches. can't know the resurrection until you actually resurrect from something. And know that it's included in the resurrection. So that is how you understand the gospel today. The complacent, self-defined religious people, the Pharisees, say, I'm going to do God's will. Yes, sir. And then they don't go. They don't go the distance. They don't even know what that means. So they didn't do God's will. Whereas the prostitutes and the tax collectors, who've gone down into the depths of human existence and know they have nothing to lose and know what all the darkness is about, they get it. They come out the inside. Because they know who they really are. No pretense, no definition, no complacency, no morality in that complacent sense. Remember, they were the only ones that resisted Jesus, not the sinners, but those who thought they weren't. So be careful, it doesn't happen to us. So when you go down into that tomb of everything you thought you were or had, had any claim to, just like Jesus did, with compassion and love and solidarity and union, pardon and forgiveness, like Jesus on the cross, at that mind in you, then you'll come out the other side and know everything, know who God is, who you are, who Christ is, but you can't know it until you undergo it.